We're good. Hey, everybody. We're having a little bit of technical difficulty this morning. That's okay. We had a little bit last week, too. So we're glad, so glad you're here with Heritage Church. My name is Michael. This is Pastor Suzanne here. If you get a chance, please text the word guest to 256-291-4996. It'll be up on the screen in just a second. While we're doing Facebook Live, you can engage on the questions on that we'll put up on the screen. We'd love to have you engage in all of that. We do have a 9 a.m. and a 10 a.m. in-person service if you'd like to be here. And, of course, we'll always do an 11 a.m. streaming.
It's so good to see you this morning. Wanted just to let you know that we are continuing our one thing. Our one thing for this month was to collect school supplies for local children. If you'd like to drop something up in the front, there's a barrel out front. You can do that contactless. And then also, we'd like to let you know that next Sunday, we'll be doing a blessing of the backpacks, and we'll be praying for anyone online who has a student that you'd like for us to pray for as well. Each and every week, we give you an opportunity to offer your worship back to God, to give back a small portion of what's been given to you, and we thank you so much for your financial faithfulness. There are three ways that you can support Heritage. You can go to our website, you can text 84321, or you can simply mail a check as well. We're also doing a special offering. We are building a cafe area out in front of the church, and you can go under our building fund on our website and be a part of that.
So we are so glad you're here today. We have a lot of things going on here at Heritage Church, and we know last week we had a little bit of problems with Facebook Live. This week we're up and running, we're streaming again, we are live here today. We're in the middle of our summer blockbuster series. So far we dove deep for Jaws, we flew to the highest heights for Star Wars, we went across back in time for Back to the Future, we aimed high for Top Gun.
What? Shoot for the stars.
We shoot for the stars. That should have been Star Wars. I think we messed up the metaphor. But this week, we ain't afraid of no ghosts, because this week we're doing Ghostbusters. It was the number one comedy of the 80s. It was the number one hit comedy of the 80s, and it earned more money than any comedy up until that point. They were actually kind of afraid because it cost them $25 million with all the special effects that had never been done before in a comedy. It cost them $25 million to make, but it made $300 million. It was actually nominated for a couple Oscars, too. And Ivan Reitman, the guy that directed it, they had a little TV ad in the movie, if you remember. It was the Ghostbusters TV ad. Had a little TV ad in there, and he overlaid a 1-800 number, and that 1-800 number that had Bill Murray and Dan Aykroyd doing a little bit on it, it got 1,000 calls an hour for 24/7 for 6 weeks, 1,000 calls an answer hour. And we looked at a lot of different themes we could kind of do with Ghostbusters. You could do ghosts or demons or hell swallowing the earth, which it seems to do all the time now. But we settled on teamwork. Teamwork is absolutely the theme of this movie, and it is a spiritual theme, believe it or not. And it means, teamwork literally means the cooperative effort for a common cause. And so the question we have for you today that you can answer live right now on Facebook Live is, what makes a great team? You know, you can answer that on Facebook Live. We'd love to hear some of your answers. What makes a great team? We practice teamwork at home, at school, at work, but especially we need to practice teamwork in the church. Literally, the word that we translate as church, the original word means the assembly of people called together for a purpose, and specifically God's purpose. But the word teamwork is not in the Bible anywhere. It's not. The idea is, the thought is there. In fact, one of the smartest people ever in all of history, King Solomon, said this about teamwork. He said, two are better than one because they have a good return for their labor. If either of them falls down, one can help the other up. But pity anyone who falls and has no one to help them up. The church is the place where we learn to worship. We learn together. We learn about scriptures and Jesus and God. We grow and we serve. But those things are always done together. This is a team sport. We worship together. We learn together. We grow together. We serve together. It doesn't happen any other way. One person said, there is no holiness except social holiness. We are supposed to be a team. We have a mission that God has set out in front of us. Our mission is to love big. We say that Heritage exists to love big. We are supposed to love our neighbors in this area so well that they feel like heaven has come to earth. And we have everything we need here as a church to fulfill that mission, but there's only one way to do it, and that is together. That is together. We need teamwork if we're going to fulfill our mission.
If teamwork is what we're supposed to do, and it's what God wants, then maybe we should spend a little time thinking about, you know, what hurts. What hurts us when it comes to teamwork? This morning, we're going to be looking at the book of Nehemiah, and it's actually your next step this week for you to read the book of Nehemiah, and we're going to be in chapter 4, and we're going to be looking at, these are the Israelites, and they had been in exile, and they want to come home, but they need a wall. In biblical times, if you didn't have a wall around your city, you were very vulnerable. People could attack you, and they wanted them to not, you know, to be able to be safe, and they were really, really struggling with this wall, and then Nehemiah comes on the scene for them. And our scripture in verse 10 says this, "Meanwhile, the people in Judah said, 'The strength of the laborers is giving out, and there's so much rubble that we cannot rebuild the wall.'" You see, the work got tough. They're trying to rebuild this wall, and the work got tough, and they got discouraged. And you know what they did? They just gave up. And don't we all do that? I mean, ask yourself this. Have you ever been on a team that struggles? I've heard it said that it's easy to get good people, but it's hard to get them to work together. And so what are the causes? What hurts a team? Well, one of the things that hurts on a team, and think about the teams that you've been on and the things you've experienced on teams. I mean, it hurts if there's apathy. Like if no one on the team really cares, that'll certainly hurt a team. And what if there's a lack of leadership? I mean, you've ever been on a team where there's no clear point person? No, a leader should do whatever it takes. They should be the most passionate people on your team. They should lead the way. They should paint a picture of the future. And then people. What about all those conflicting personalities? I mean, there's no question God created us all differently. So you've got some people on your team who are super critical. I mean, they only point out what's wrong. But most times the ones who are super critical never do anything to try and correct that. Then you have people on teams who are lone rangers. They like to just do it by myself. I don't want to work with anybody else. That's hard to be on a team with somebody like that. Then there's me monsters, where everything on the team is all about them. You've heard that saying, there's no I in team, but me monsters, it's all about I. And then we have slackers. Oh, have you ever been on a team with a bunch of slackers? You know what a slacker looks like. They have more excuses than effort. I mean, it's like they have a PhD in excuses. You know, when I was teaching, I was thinking a little bit about going into ministry, and God had put a call on my life, and I was thinking about leaving the classroom, but I loved being a teacher. Like, I loved being there every day, and so, you know, that slacker mentality that's part of our culture was kind of getting into me a little bit, because, you know, like, we have phrases like, everybody's working for the weekend, and, you know, all we want to do, we want to work really hard so we can retire and do nothing, and so that slacker thing. So I talked to a friend of mine about it. I said, you know, I feel like God's got this call in my life, but I've kind of got it made, you know, in the class. I've been teaching a long time. I could just coast till retirement. And my friend looked at me and he said, why would you want to coast? Mm. And isn't that so true when we're talking about God's team? Why would we want to coast on God's team? We all need to work together. I mean, some of us, we're also, there are people on our teams that want to be superstars. If you know, they always want to have all the credit. They don't want to share the credit with the team. And then there's some people on our team, they're just tired. They are worn out with life. They are just overwhelmed. But another thing, so those are kind of some of the personalities. But then sometimes we, you know, a team will just have unclear goals. I mean, we want to be real clear. The goal of the church is to share the love of Jesus with everybody. The role of the church is to equip you so you can go out and share the love of Christ with everyone else. So we can bring a little bit of heaven on earth in our own community. Now, I know a lot of us have been on teams where we've experienced the next one, which is a lack of appreciation. I mean, everybody needs appreciation mm-hmm. from time to time. Just a little pat on the back, you know, that a girl or that a boy. Scripture tells us that we should encourage one another daily. I mean, there's no person in the whole wide world. Sometimes it's like we're kind of embarrassed about it, and we don't want to admit that we like to be appreciated, but it's just part of our humanity that we want to be appreciated. And then maybe the biggest thing that hurts a team, I think, is that sometimes there's just a lack of awareness about why teams are so important. You know, people just aren't aware, and they just think, you know, and especially if it's a pretty well-running team and things are getting done, you know, they're just not aware that their contribution is needed. I noticed it at church recently at Vacation Bible School, how everybody just worked as a team. I think that a lot of times when it comes to teams, it winds up being something like this in the church. Everybody thought somebody would do it, but nobody did it. We need to recognize that teamwork is central to what we do when we follow God. I mean, the mission at Heritage Church, it ceases the second we stop working together. Because the mission is just too big for two pastors. It's too big for two pastors and staff. It's too big for two pastors, staff, and a leadership team. It takes all of us to fulfill the mission God has given us to bring a little bit of heaven here to our community. To love big as God's called us to do. You see, it takes teamwork to fulfill our mission.
You know, it's so true. Karen said when she answered a question, just to let you know, we are live today, so we're doing this. Karen said trust is the number one thing for a team, what makes a good team. So, you know, this is what God wants. In fact, Jesus, the first thing he did in his active ministry is he went and recruited a team. And then when he'd take those disciples and he'd send them out in teams. He'd send them out minimally, just two of them, but at least you had a team. And then his followers got to the point after Jesus went to heaven and said, it's on you guys now. His followers figured out real quick that they had to develop teams. It was just overwhelming. It grew so fast that so many people, they were getting overwhelmed. They needed teams around them. And then every church became a team. And then there's teams within those churches. And here's the thing. All of us have a place on that team. No one is exempt. I don't care what age you are. I don't care what background you are. I don't care how much money you have or don't have. I don't care what your history is. We all have a role. We all have a place. This mission, as Pastor Suzanne said, is too big for just one person. God wants everybody to save. He loves the whole world, right? And wishes everybody to be saved. And it's going to take all of us to set this world right. What we need to do is say yes to that team. So here's the next question. What makes a good team player? If we're called to be on teams, what makes a good team player? And if you've been around churches or any kind of team, I think it's the 20-80 rule. It says that 20% of the people on a team always do 80% of the work. And so some smart aleck said, you know what, let's go do a study on it. Somebody in seminary said, I'm going to get my PhD on this. And they went and did a study, and they figured out that it's actually 25% in the churches they studied did 100% of the work. And then somebody said, that doesn't sound right. I don't think it's that much. And they said, no, it's 8% do 100% of the work. And I don't even care if you average it out. It's still only 16.5% doing 100% of the work in the church. And it's no wonder we struggle with effectiveness as churches, as God's church here in the world. It takes everyone doing their part for this to happen. You know, Nehemiah was brilliant when he pulled his people together. He got them all together, and he did this, and this is in Nehemiah 4. He says, I stationed the people to stand guard. He's kind of relating this in his own narrative. He wrote this. I stationed the people to stand guard by families. There's kind of a key. Armed with swords and spears and bows. And we worked from early to late, from sunrise to sunset, and half of the men were always on guard. Everyone pitched in on this. He reorganized them into teams. They were struggling doing it the way they were doing it because they weren't organized in a team. They were just people doing little things, and they run out of steam. Half of them would stand guard, and the other half would work, and then they'd alternate when they got tired. And he posted them by groups and families because those families were bonded, and they took care of each other. They encouraged each other. They supported each other. And they were placed by their own homes sometimes to fix the wall near their home in their neighborhood, right? So those tight groups probably got the most done. And they rebuilt the wall under a threat of attack. They were being attacked while they were doing this. 52 days is what it took them to build the wall. 52 days. And it's just amazing that they were able to come together in a team to do this. So what helps teams? What helps a team? What makes a good team player? You know, the first thing is, as a church, what will help us as a team is to understand that we are a family. You have a natural family, but you have a spiritual family too. The baptism we did here the other day, that was an adoption into the family of Christ, right? And it doesn't mean you ignore your natural family. You probably need to spend more time with them. But you have a spiritual family surrounding you. We have each other's backs. If one person falls, like some churches, I think, that are going down the wrong path, like if one person falls down, the others take their spears and poke them and move on, right? You know, we don't want the weak one, right? We're not supposed to eat our young. We're not supposed to do that. We're supposed to surround them and help them get back up and get in the game, right? That's what we're supposed to do. So we're a family, and we need each other. And it takes all of us. It takes all of us to do this. This mission is too big, and the threat is too real. A lot like the movie, hell is trying to swallow up earth. And if you look at some of the families that don't have God and don't have a sense of God, they're playing this game, and it's hell's game in this world. We have got to get urgency about this because we are under attack. And minimally, if you can't or are unable or unwilling to work at a part on this team, at the very least, you ought to have your spear and your sword standing up, protecting those who are doing the work. You ought to be praying for them. Because if you don't think that a person needs prayer that is actually functioning on a team for God, you don't know our enemy. That enemy is coming after that person, and they need people to protect them in prayer. So minimally, if you can't or won't or unable to work, you should be at the very least praying for those people. And it takes trust. You know, we know we're supposed to trust God, but we're also supposed to learn how to trust one another. And granted, there's levels of trust, right? I mean, everybody comes in a different condition. We're all works in progress. And so you trust some people that have proven themselves a lot more than you trust others. But the best thing to do to kind of to learn how to trust is to become trustworthy yourself. Be that person that has everybody's back. Be that person that doesn't gossip about somebody if they're struggling. Be that person that prays for your team members. And finally, we need to be connected. I love what Nehemiah did. He put them with family, right? He said, you're the most effective when you feel like you belong to the group that you're working with, that you feel bonded to them. And this only happens when we're always saying, get on a team, work on a team, or get in a small group. Get in one of our connection groups, which we're going to do this fall. It happens. You become bonded to your family in those moments, in those personal relationships. You know, we are going to need teamwork if we're going to fulfill our mission.
You know, it's been said that the church is the hope of the world. If you think about it, God put Heritage here for a reason. Mm-hmm. And it's our hope that we could be the team that God would want us to be. And what could happen if we could blend our abilities, our talents, our gifts? And what if we could just cooperate with each other, be on a team, and have energy for the shared mission that God has given us? That mission to bring a little piece of heaven here on earth. You know, there's this great scripture in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 9, where it says this, we are co-workers in God's service. It's a pretty simple way in Scripture. It may not use the word teamwork, but pretty much telling you we're all on God's team together. And what could happen if everyone decided they were really going to engage and be on the team? When I taught school, I had a poster in my classroom for years, and it had the acrostic team, and it said, together, everyone achieves more. I'm sure you've heard that saying before. But aren't burdens lighter when everyone works together? And I think in the pandemic, our default has been to, isolate. But maybe now's the time where we begin to drive our lives. We get back in the driver's seat of our lives, and we stop the isolation, and we lean more into connection. You know, on Ghostbusters, this is an amazing thing. You know, when they complete their mission, there was much celebration. I mean, they had to overcome a lot, but they came together as a team, and there was a lot of celebration. And can you imagine the celebration we would have if we could live out our shared mission in our community? Have you ever seen a team that just really looks like a great team, and maybe you're not even on it? I had an experience once. I went to the gym, and I went to what I thought was a class, And come to find out, it was like a CrossFit thing. And, it, you know, the first thing they said, okay, come on in. They said, the first thing we're going to do, we're going to go run a mile. And so, you know, we go and we run a mile. And we come back and it was like 100 burpees, 100 sit-ups, 100 push-ups, you know, whatever. And so I did those things and I was behind everybody. I mean, I was dead last. So everybody else was pretty much done and I had to go do that last mile.
Ugly mile.
But those people, you know, as I'm doing that mile, they all came out and ran that mile with me. I got to tell y'all, I mean, it's no fun to be dead last, and I was dead last. But it felt good. I felt good about it because I was on a team. Isn't that what a team does? A team accepts you for who you are. A team encourages you. A team serves you. A team loves you. And a team is something that comes together to live out a shared mission. And in the church, the team should call out your giftedness. We should come alongside of you. And as we follow Christ, we should always give God our best. You know, like all movies, at the end of Ghostbusters, the credits roll and the movie's over, mission accomplished, it's done. But it's a whole lot different in the mission that God's given us. Our mission never ends. And the beautiful thing is it's never, ever too late to join in. Won't you join God's team? You see, it takes teamwork to fulfill our mission. Each and every week at Heritage, we give you next steps. These steps are for you to challenge yourself and grow in your faith. Jesus continually wanted us to grow closer to him, and you have to take these steps. No one can do it for you. You have to do so. Our next steps this week, we encourage you to read the book of Nehemiah. And then, you know, think about this. Maybe you can send us an email. Let us know, you know, what your thoughts are on this next question. When it comes to being a team member at Heritage, I need to. What is it that you need to do? How has God spoken to you? You know, one of the beautiful things about God is he speaks to each of us in the way that we need to hear it. What you need may not be what I need, but God is always speaking. And then maybe you tuned in this morning and you've not yet joined God's team, but you're curious about Jesus. We want you to know that as far as Jesus is concerned, it doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter how many times you've stumbled. It doesn't matter how far you are from God. Jesus wants to be in a relationship with him. And if you want to say yes to him, please let us know that, and we will help you take your next steps. We will surround you with a team so that you can grow in your knowledge of Christ and his love for you. And then maybe if you'd like to be baptized, we can help with that as well.
We're so glad you were on today. We're glad we could get on today. Sorry about the technical difficulties last week, but we're alive and on today. I love, like, there were still answering questions. Tammy said, a desire for success makes for good teams. Like, you know, when we all want success.
Together, everyone achieves more.
And that's this that's church. It. You know, do you have a desire for success for this church? We know we do. We know the people that are coming here, almost all of them want to see this church do something big for God. So let's do it. You know, we do 9 and 10 a.m. in-person services if you feel comfortable coming. If you, for whatever reason, can't make it, 11 a.m., we will continue to stream on Facebook Live. If you have kids, get on Your Heritage Kids on Facebook. If you have a prayer request, put those in the chats. Let us know if you need anything. So let me pray for us as we go out of today and into some music from our praise team, from our worship team. So let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that you have called this team together. Thank you for the ones that were here and the ones that couldn't be here today and got online anyway. We thank you that we are a team for this area, that you have called us out for this area. So, Father, help us be the best team we can possibly be. Help us beat all of the numbers and all the percentages to be the team that is all in this area. Show us what to do. Show us where to jump in. Show us how to be the best team ever. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Y'all have a great week. We love you.
Bye, y'all.